All right, everybody, it is the Drinking with Drew show. I think we have everything working today. No mishaps as of yet. It's April 4th, for those keeping track on the calendar. I know if we don't say the date, Garbee gets lost. We have some awesome guests in the show tonight. So we're looking forward to introducing those folks. This is the Drinking with Drew show. I'm Drew. I'm fucking drinking. Joe's in the house, although not on camera tonight. He's got his karaoke microphone, so he'll be peeping in. He's on Simon watch tonight. We have Laura. What's up, Laura? And Tampa attorney Josh Sheridan is in the house. I guess, do you want me to unmute everybody now?
That'd be good, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Josh is a local attorney here in Tampa. We'll talk a little bit about his life, career, and dreams and desires. We have music producer, entrepreneur, and man of many mysteries, Jarrett Pritchard, in the house. What's up, Jarrett?
What's up?
And we do have Garbee in the back. What's up, Garb?
My camera sucks.
I mean, you look okay. True. You look okay. I mean, you know.
Your lighting is awful, too.
No, it's not. He's got, I mean, he's got a little tan going.
A little pinkish.
Yeah.
It's fine. All right. Did you test that microphone, Joe?
No. Testing? No.
Oh, yeah. I don't know what's going on with you. Try it again?
Just yell really loud. No.
Yeah. You might be out for the count. I don't know. We'll have to figure it out. It was working. Maybe we'll get Jarrett back there to do a mic check.
Simon's butt probably wired. Pulled a cord out or something.
It's a story of my entire life. Why is this mic not working?
Yeah, I mean.
Oh, yeah. Last 2 weeks.
Right?
We got 1, 2, 3. I don't know. If you really need to, you can come up here and.
Yeah.
You know,
then you can get
not,
on camera
not even
too.
If you really need to. I mean, if you want to, you can come up here and, you know, use Laura's camera.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well. So. I dragged Jarrett out from Orlando to come on the show. Jarrett, I haven't seen you in probably been 10 years. I saw you at Crowbar.
Yeah, it's been a minute.
You were doing sound out there. I don't remember what show it was.
Possessed, maybe.
Yeah. And you just did a Possessed show, right?
Yeah, and Hell's Here is in Houston. I had Hellhammer, Triumph of Death the first night. Then I had Possessed the next night. And then I had Trypticon doing the Celtic Frost set on Saturday night. So it was, you know, I mean, it was mind-blowing because those are all my... you know, formative bands or whatever.
Right. I mean, I really do want to read this thing, Jarrett. I mean, I know you sent it to me kind of as a joke, but I mean, it does kind of give us a big synopsis of what you've done. I mean, it's impressive to say the least. I mean,
well, thanks.
So I know I'm going to miss a few, but just bands and people you've worked with, Goat Whore, Exhumed, Brutality, Nocturnus, you have Kiefer Sutherland on there?
Yeah, he does like country music. I was with him for a couple of years doing his in-ear monitors.
Okay. And
is he a Tool?
No, God, no. He's like the nicest guy on earth.
Okay.
Really? Did you ever meet his dad?
No, and I really wish that I had met Donald, but no. I got the call. A bunch of people did it wrong. Somebody called me and asked me to do it. I went in there. I met Kiefer. He was partying at the, you know, with the band or whatever. He walks up to me and says, if you figure this out, I'll buy you a house. And I laughed and I said, I literally said, you better get your fucking checkbook out, bro, because this is done. And then the next day I did a show in Boston with him. And then, you know, then we went and through that couple years that I did that, I did a bunch of recording, like live stuff that went on BBC radio and stuff with him and just toured with him. He's a really nice guy.
Did he buy the house?
No.
So he's a Tool.
No, he's not. He doesn't have to buy me a house. That's what they hired me to do. Make it work, you know?
Okay. That's cool. Josh, I know you're not allowed to talk about all of your famous family law attorneys and your criminal defense attorney clients, but, you know, that's the thing about attorney-client privilege. I also have it, so I can't, you know, I'm not allowed to talk either, so, you know.
I've represented at least one band on your wall.
You know.
And you know who it is.
I do.
How's the roof in this room? Is it going to?
Yeah. I was actually going to talk about that story, a story later in reference to that, because I have it in the news, because it is news. So are we allowed to talk about a band that had an issue? Yeah, I think we can. Anyways, so Jarrett and I used to party back in the day. We used to play every venue in Tampa, Brass Mug, back when it was, you know, a hole in the wall Brass Mug, Sunset Club. I think you were there.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know, man. There was just so many little hot spots in Ybor. And even I talked about a party we played a while back, which was where the guy stole our equipment and we had to chase him down and beat his ass and, you know, things like that back in the day. I mean, you know, shit happens.
Was that in Ybor?
No, it was actually off of River Hill somewhere or something. I don't know. It was Temple Terrace, man. Temple Terrace was wild back in the day.
Yeah, we played an empty swimming pool.
Yeah.
Empty swimming.
That's the way you did it back in the day, man. We, you know, built suicidal. You had to do it that way.
Built a stage in the shallow end and, you know, called up our friends and, you know, Deranged Mentality Artistic Butchery. Said, hey, we're doing a show. Come on down here. Get down here.
Yep.
And that's how we would do it, you know, just word of mouth, you know, no internet, just, hey, there's a party, there's bands, get here.
I mean, even garages, just, we used to have garage parties and, you know, play in the garage and shit. I mean, that was the days, man. You could just do that kind of stuff. And
shit, man, I'll still play your garage.
Yeah, I know, right? I mean, I got leather couches in there right now.
I'm into it.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean.
Bitchin' strobe light in there, too.
I do, yeah. And I showed that to Jared. He's like, yeah, that's badass. We use those. I'm trying to think, like, what timeline, because it seemed like you just vanished. Like, I don't know what timeline it was, but there was a time in my life where Jarrett was no longer around. I'm like,
keeper saw that on years.
Maybe.
I mean, I did eulogy from 89 to 95, and then I just, you know, wanted to be an engineer. So
I'm not saying you personally disappeared. I mean, out of my, like, you moved, when did you leave Tampa?
95, I went to Virginia to engineer, and, you know, okay. I did that for a long time, and then when I, you know, had an opportunity, I got asked to take a job in Orlando teaching how to make records, and I came and did that.
Did the vinyl record timeline hit you hard? Did that fuck with your career at all? Or because I know everybody went from digital, you know, from vinyl to digital, and now vinyl's coming back. So
I don't see that. I mean, the streaming has an impact on everybody. There's no two ways about that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I mean, it is what it is. People, you know, are going to do things all kinds of different ways. And some, if you're lucky, you stay a part of that. And yeah. I feel pretty fortunate that I still am able to work, to be honest.
Yeah, for sure. So, Josh, you're doing some recording now. Are you going to be recording in vinyl? Are you bringing it back?
I'm, am I recording in vinyl? I'm hoping to put out vinyl. I don't know.
Are you going to be
once
producing
Taylor Swift
vinyl?
And Adele are done with all their records, you know, taking up every pressing plant. But yeah, I'd like to.
Yeah.
For the five people who might buy it.
Well,
three.
Maybe
my parents are dead now, so three. Look, people might.
We've got six viewers, so right. I mean, we're picking up the fucking content tonight.
Seven now. Oh, wow.
Look at us, man.
It's a record, you guys.
It's a record.
Wow. Keep it going, guys. Let's get to 10.
Yeah.
What happens if we get the double digits?
Yeah. This will be 100 views by the end of the night. So, Josh, I know you're crazy as hell busy working in the law business, but I know you do both criminal, family. Give me a breakdown of your practice, because I know you've got a shit ton of attorneys in your office.
Personally, I'm divorce and family law pretty much. I do a good deal of criminal, but it's all just kind of passive. I don't really market for it. So usually it's a husband who gets arrested during the pendency of a divorce, or a wife who gets, you know, something like that. And I'll get, you know, just, you know, random criminal stuff. But I don't do nearly as much as Hackworth or some of these other people. But I don't think anybody does anything
watch
as much
you
as
don't
Hackworth.
Have to name drop him.
He might be tonight. We have seven viewers. He's still hungover from his birthday.
Yeah.
So, but you're, how many attorneys do you have in your office now?
Not, oops. The dog.
It does that.
That's right. Earthquake. I think it's nine-ish, nine or 10, but it's kind of different because some are full-time, some are kind of counsel part-time, and some are raising my children. So our children.
Don't drop any of them off at the house. Right. Well, unless they're, I don't know. Can they babysit wiener dogs? Maybe, are they old enough to do that? That's pretty much all I need in my life right now.
My son will talk your ear off about Star Wars. So
there you go.
Yeah. You guys can talk about.
It's always a thing.
Yeah.
We've got.
You'll be best friends in no time.
We got approved to go to the TV show taping tomorrow of Pawn Stars.
Mm-hmm. I heard talk of this, and I heard what your offering is going
to
be.
Well, my offering. Her he offer. Has Hers. To figure out.
I have to offering. Find something to auction off. I don't know what it, I mean.
We just found, like, we sent in, like, the request for tickets this weekend, and then they emailed, like, late last night. So I was at work just checking my email, and I was like, shit, like, it's for tomorrow. And I'm like, oh, great. So I had to, like, get time off work. And then they throw in there, after you've gotten the tickets, that you have to bring an item. Everyone has to bring an item. And so now we're trying to pull that together.
Do they travel around, or is that where they film it?
This new season, they're traveling. So they'll be doing tapings in different cities for the new season.
They're based in Vegas, right?
Right. Yeah.
It's called Pawn Stars Do America.
So fitting.
What do you think the number one object's going to be?
The Michael Jackson doll I'm bringing.
I don't know. I mean, it's Florida.
Yeah, Florida Pawn Stars is going to be a lot of meth and bodies that weren't found for 3 decades.
Jared, do you have any some like old vinyl I can bring, like that they would be mesmerized about, like, you know, some old Venom or
that
something?
That you can bring back by 1 o'clock tomorrow?
I mean, yeah, but I don't know if it's going to the pawn shop, bro.
He just wants to get on the show. Man. You don't necessarily have to sell anything, but he just wants to get on the show with something cool.
Yeah. I could, like, just act like I'm pawning it and then take it back real quick.
Yeah.
What'd you say? You have a leather-bound motorhead?
Yeah, a client gifted me a leather-bound motorhead. The vinyl's fried. You can't play it, but the leather sleeve is pretty cool.
Oh, damn.
That'll be easy to carry around.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, people are going to be bringing trucks. I mean, I'm sure, like, trailers and trucks with shit, whatever, cars, who knows?
Well, they said not to bring anything heavy because you're going to have to carry it around for a while. I mean, I'm sure they may have people that are on the show for sure with something large, but for us little extras, they just said bring something that you can carry around.
And they told us up front we're not getting paid.
Right. No compensation.
I'm going to just take a sticker, Drinking with Drew, stick in my forehead.
There you go.
There you go.
Branding.
You have, like, a huge picture of a moose or anything you could?
That's true. Yeah. I mean, we can take the moose.
That's a special moose, though, you know? I mean, I don't know. We'll see. Jarrett, what album are you working on right now? I saw you posting some solos and riffs that you're putting together.
Yeah, I'm working on a band called Svart Lotus from Norway. That's the bassist of 1349, has a side band, and this will be, like, the third or fourth record I've done for him, and I'm... They track it over there and they send it to me and I mix it, and usually he asks me to play like a lead somewhere on it. And so I've been trying to bag that for about a week because I should practice way more than I do.
So people don't understand how huge, because that's black metal, right? I mean, that's Norway's, like, I don't know. It seemed like the number one freaking area for black metal.
Yeah.
It's like when they come to the United States, I mean, typically their shows are always sold out. I mean, they're pretty huge here, but I mean, in Norway, it's like fucking amazing.
They have a very dedicated, very rabid following. I've done, you know, a lot of tours with 1349 and bands, you know, that support them. And, you know, they do well here. A lot of people really like it. They're really into it. And so, it supports itself. So we've been doing it for like 14 years. I've been with 1349 for like 14 years now. So, I mean, it must be working because we keep doing it.
Right.
You know.
Are you guys and this is kind of like, Josh, you're not going out trying to get signed right now. Like seems like every musician is just kind of doing it on their own these days. Is that the best route?
I don't think anybody who is doing it right now is doing it to make money, or at least most people aren't. You just, you know.
It depends on what you're looking for. I mean, the labels, in my opinion, and I know a lot of labels, so people that work for them and everything else, the labels to me at this point, what they bring is reach and PR. So you can, you know, I mean, I can go home, write a song and record it and put it out right now, like, and put it on Spotify and put it on YouTube and do this, that, and the other.
Will you call it Drinking with Drew? Rocks.
I'm gonna do exactly that as soon as I get out of here. But the reach is what the labels bring to the table. On the, at the lower levels, I would say that the the deals aren't great. I mean, I still play in a band with Clayton from Eulogy and Polka Morte, and we've done two records ourselves. And, you know, we've got, you know, Adam from Skeleton Witch sings vocals, John from Abigail Williams and Wolfhammer plays bass for us, and we've done all the records ourselves. And we had offers. They just weren't good offers. And it was the kind of thing where it's like, okay, we'll give you a tiny amount of money to record it. Since I recorded, I know that doesn't even come close to what the time I put in it was. Right. The publishing is going to be X, you know, and you know, I told a label and they didn't take it very well. I told a label that you trying to tell me how publishing works is like walking into a casino and asking the dealer how to play blackjack. And right. They didn't find that very funny. I thought it was hilarious. They didn't find me amusing at all. The mechanical percentages are better than they were, like, say, during the freshman class of Tampa, like when all those bands got signed. You know, I think they were maybe pulling like 12% was pretty normal. It's way better than that, but unfortunately you don't sell physical records.
Right.
And then where it bites is that they all want digital. Even the smallest labels, like somebody's like, oh, I'm going to put this record out in, you know, Europe for you, and I'm going to do all this PR, and, you know, we're going to have a $2,000 or whatever it may be PR budget, and then we have to recoup that, but we want all the digital. We want 60% of the digital, and anybody that's got half a brain goes, yeah, nah, man. It's almost like giving your publishing away, because that's the medium that everyone listens to music in at this point. I mean, we all are on YouTube, we're all on Spotify, you know, right. We're Pandora, we're all streaming most of our music. People aren't running around really with physical products anymore. And so what little revenue is generated by that, unless you're, you know, like Adele or something, you know, you're just giving it away. I mean, so I agree with you. Sorry, that was long-winded. It's okay. I don't think anybody playing is doing it, quote unquote, to get rich. And I think anybody that's, you know, playing the local bar expecting the magic record man to show up and sweep you away is severely misguided.
I remember, though, back in the day when we were playing, you know, little clubs, and my mom would just always be like, you never know, there could be a scout in the audience. And that was like our big thing, was like, oh, there could be. And so, you know, we get up there and just always assume that one weirdo in the back was like watching us to promote us, but he's just probably whacking off to us in the bathroom or something, you know?
I mean, if I...
That was a bad night for me. I'm sorry. I'm going through some stuff.
Thought I remembered you from somewhere.
If I had any advice to sum that up for anybody that's trying to start a band or whatever, or do a band or be successful at it, unfortunately, the harsh reality is get in the van.
Mm-hmm.
That's
Josh just sold his though.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, that's
get in my van,
get in your car. I mean, you know, whatever you
have. There's a sign on my van that says get in my van.
Talk your wife into not making you sell the van. That's what you need to do, Josh.
But it feels like you have to go get them one by one. It feels like you have to go out and, you know, play. Because there's such a blinding mass of media that you can select on the internet.
But the type of music you get in a van and go play, that doesn't even... Where do you hear that now? I mean, unless you seek out the record. I mean, you don't hear it on the radio.
No.
You don't. It's all... I don't know if it's EDM or what it is, but it's not the type of music that you're describing or that I came up on. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yep. Well,
I think, you know, every market's different. I think they work different. I think metal's really simple, actually. I think the river's very clear. This is the website. This is the magazine. These are the labels. These are the blogs. If you know anything about the Network of America, these are the clubs. If mm-hmm. you don't know, you can ask somebody. I mean, because sure. Everybody's on Facebook. Just ask, you know. And you got to bring it to them. You know, I worked for a long time with a band called Godor, and I would say that the secret to their success, having been with them for a long time, is that they get in the van, they rough it, and they go out and they bring a spectacular live show
mm-hmm.
to every hole in the wall, you know. And you know, I've had people ask me, like, well, why do you do that? You know, it's like so punk rock or so DIY or whatever. Show up in Johnson City, Tennessee, where it's economically dead and there's nothing going on, and, you know, 250 kids are getting a show. And the minute that you see 250 fists go in the air, like, you really, that's why you do it. Like, yep. That's who you're going to, that's who you bring it to.
Right.
Well, and arguably, that type of music has the most loyal fan base, too. I mean,
I agree completely.
These bands that you're naming, you know, there's fans from first record to last record, and we're talking a catalog of 10, 11, 12, 13, you know, Obituary just put out a record, and, you know, my wife grew up next to them, and people can locally, I know Drew can just name every song, every lyric, every album, and I don't think you find that in other types of music.
Isn't it fantastic how hard obituary continues to stomp?
Yeah.
It's crazy, man.
I mean, you don't, like, I would say, having done a million shows, mixing them or whatever, like, I can't think of anybody that would want to follow that band. It's it makes me laugh so hard every time I see them. And my buddy Joe is their front of house guy, and he's a fantastic engineer, and they just...
What's Joe's last name?
Sincata.
Okay. I met when they last played Brass Mug, I met one of their guys. I'm trying to remember what his name is now.
And they just stomp so hard. It's amazing.
They're pushing 60.
They've been around forever, man.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I saw them when they were called Executioner.
Yeah.
Right.
At the Sunset Club, actually.
Yep. It's crazy. All right. So I hear we have a message from a viewer.
This one's going out to the Drinking with Drew show. Hey, Garbee. Oh my God, I'm sorry I missed you on the last one. I heard you cried like a little bitch in front of all four viewers. Yeah. You guys really need to get some more viewers. I'm so sorry. It was such a long list. I didn't mean to miss you. That was completely unintentional. So, Garbee, this is just for you. Too bad you didn't win on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, because who doesn't? But, oh well. Hopefully you'll have fun on the Drinking with Drew show. You guys fucking rock. I hope you get more viewers. Much love.
Oh my God.
So you have a fan apparently now, Garbee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, he's on the camera.
You can thank Joe for that.
Yeah.
How did he get his camera knocked off that far?
I don't know. Simon probably somehow did it with his mind.
Can you adjust it a smidgel? All right, technical difficulties.
When Katie was bouncing, it moved.
Yeah, right. That's probably true. So, Joe, or.
Is it going to autofocus?
It might. We'll see. You know. We got Garbee on the shit cam tonight.
Yeah.
Sorry, Garbee. Sorry. I mean, doing my best over here. So, Joe, do you want to come up and kind of give a synopsis of you know, he's responsible for that, by the way.
Thanks, Joe.
Can you...
celebrity endorsements.
We're just going to send her enough of those. She's going to come in this fucking studio, I swear to God. She will be in here.
Yeah.
Katie, or mark your fucking calendar, Tampa, Florida.
Or file a restraining
order. Get your ass in here. Well, that, if she does that, it's towards Joe.
Yeah, right.
Listed on the original request. So you're
we don't know how much Joe's sending her outside of the show. Like, he could have already sent her dick pics. I don't know. I'm not responsible for anything Joe does on his own.
If you need a professional opinion, you know, who better to send it to, right?
Yeah, I've got an attorney sitting right here. You know, we could probably type up a contract right now. No wieners allowed in the show, Joe. So, Greg, do you want to respond? We can send her an official response.
Oh, we can?
Yeah.
No, that's okay.
All right.
Are you going to show your wife when you get home?
She might have already seen it. She might have been one of the seven viewers.
Have you gotten a text message yet?
I don't know. Oh, I did.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Did you really?
She must be one of those.
That's hilarious. That's hilarious. Okay, well,
that's awesome.
Yeah, Brian said injunction. That's hilarious. All right, it's funny watching the comments while we're doing the show, but it also kind of bores people who are watching it. So I'll try not to stare at the screen too much while we're doing that. And I don't want to talk about news too much, but we do have a segment called Drew News. And those of you don't know, it's a new segment called Drew News.
I was gonna say first time.
Looky there, Drew News. Josh, I know you're going to love this. Jarrett, I haven't talked to you in a million years. I don't know your political affiliation. I personally don't care.
Are you just going
to
leave that picture up there?
No,
shut
up. Jesus Christ. Yeah, I might. So Donald Trump was arrested today, indicted and arrested, turned himself in, yada, yada. Josh, what are your thoughts on the whole situation? I mean, I've heard everything from legitimate charges, not legitimate charges. Nobody really knows. Now they're unsealed. People know what they're about. Do you foresee him sticking?
I mean, he's got at least 9 lives. You know, there was more serious stuff that I would have imagined would have gotten him before. So I don't know. There was a time when I knew way more about this stuff and followed it more closely. I kind of have PTSD from watching it too much. But
the
Southern District
of
New York generally don't file things if they don't think they can prove them. And I think that's who's on this one, right?
Well, Alvin Bragg is the guy who's behind it, but I mean, I don't know much about him, and he just became a household name like as of a week ago. I mean, I saw his statement. It seemed like he has his ducks in a row.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the goal is here. You know, the timing of it's a little bit late. if it's politically motivated, unless they're seriously worried about him beating DeSantis, or I don't know.
Jared, any thoughts?
You know, Jared's just an old punk rocker. I don't care.
I like Jared's answer better.
Can I have mine over? I have zero faith in any of it. If they, I mean, indict Donald Trump, okay, cool. Is he like the first president to ever be indicted? Is that true?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, only the second to be arrested.
Okay. Maybe since Nixon. Okay. So, right.
It was a president that was arrested for going too fast on his buggy, his horse and buggy.
Oh, good God!
They had speeding laws with horse and buggies.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
Oh my God.
There's a Joe Biden joke there somewhere, but
that is true.
This is a weird one to put on your podcast. I'll tell you this real quick. You probably don't even know this. My dad was a really pretty high up there, like scientist guy, acoustics engineer for NASA for about 30 years.
Really?
When I figured out what it meant, we had a conversation, and his answer to me about most of the world was just this. Jarrett, no one knows shit, and if you did know shit, you'd be fucking dead. So whatever comes across to me through the news media or whatever, I personally take it with a grain of salt. If I speak to friends that have different opinions, I see validity in anything that anybody I bother to respect to listen to has to say. He's arrested. Neat. Let's see what happens next. Maybe he'll hang himself in the tombs.
Garbee.
So since this is Drew's news, why don't you, what I didn't see what, all I know about is the hush money payment. Which I think is...
Well, they're all related to business. It's basically... it's all related to...
it's like 34 counts.
34 felony counts.
Yeah.
Of New York-related business fraud.
Yeah, I mean, he probably did illegal shit.
Yeah.
I
think it is all... It's entirely politically motivated.
Does he serve time?
No.
I don't think so.
His next appearance in court is until December.
But I have no basis for that. You know.
Yeah.
I'd be surprised if he does.
Can you grab me a Guinness while we're talking?
I can.
Okay. Are you still shocked from Katie Morgan?
Are you gonna save it for the beer test?
Yes, we're doing it right now.
Oh, we're doing the beer test now?
Yep. Okay. Actually, you want to do that? You want to pass around the beers? Yeah, let's do it. Great timing, Greg.
Hold on. Here's my take on it. Because I'm forgotten over here.
I mean, you can have a take, I guess.
Right. Well, I'm just going to go off of kind of what Josh said as he was saying that, you know, you'd think that there would be other things. Like
take one, pass it down.
That,
take one, pass it down.
Never mind.
Well, bring it down. Come on. We're passing beers around. You got to turn around. Go ahead, Laura, while we're waiting.
I was just saying that if he is... you know, guilty of doing larger crimes that they can't necessarily prove, do you think they're going to try and take them down like they used to take down the mobsters where they couldn't get them for murder, so they're going to get them for tax evasion?
Oh, well, I mean, possibly, yeah. That's a good thought.
Haha. See? I may not know where Amsterdam is, but I sure as hell can have a good question every now and then.
That was a statement. I mean, well, it's kind of a statement question. All right, so here's what we're going to do. We're going to try this new beer. Do you want to open yours or you just want to taste mine?
No, I definitely want to try peanut butter jelly with the grape and blackberry.
Do you really think? Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
Can we call this section peanut butter jelly time?
We could.
We have to call it that.
Yes.
We are calling it Drew's Taste Test. All right. We try to get people film, like taking a sip on film, so I'm going to.
Did you buy this in store or did you order it?
No, I bought it in store.
It's right by my office.
Is it? All right. Can we get a close-up of the can? I don't know if I'm going to be able to do that without spilling it everywhere this time.
There you go.
It has literally, crayons, sandwiches, teddy bears, Nintendo.
And his fingers right on the name.
And there's a firearm in there somewhere. There's a shotgun. I mean,
sure.
Who's the marketing going to, Josh?
I don't know.
Men child.
Attorney.
Middle-aged podcast enthusiast.
So, Jared, you haven't drank it. You're not a heavy drinker, but what do you think?
Dessert.
Yeah, tastes like a liquid sandwich.
Yeah.
Liquid sandwich. Yeah. That sounds like a sexual move. Like a.
It does sound like a.
Like a rusty trombone and a liquid sandwich.
New band name.
Yep. Right. Liquid sandwich. Ooh, true. Can we do it?
Garbee, what's your opinion? Take a big sip of it.
That's pretty good. I imagine that's what Katie Morgan tastes like.
check your text. There goes another couple of texts. I'm going to leave some of my cards on the way. Yes, out, so. Yes.
Indeed. Joe, do you want to come up and share a mic with Laura and give your...
Get up, then Simon's going to move.
All right, we'll talk loud.
I'm good.
You good?
I can hand you the mic.
Thumbs up or thumbs down? Sideways.
About halfway. A little bit up.
Sideways thumbs.
Yeah, I mean...
A little up. That's what you tell your wife. It's a little up.
All right, Laura.
I actually think it's good, and I'm not a beer fan, but I could drink this one.
It doesn't taste like a beer.
It doesn't.
It doesn't. Like, you get hit with, like, the peanut butter. That's what I'm tasting more than anything.
Yeah. I kind of wish it didn't have the carbonation in it, though. Like, I wish it was just like a wine cooler. Gatorade. Does that sound?
It tastes like somebody microwaved a bunch of Reese's Pieces.
Well.
Skittles.
Yeah.
Can you hand me a Guinness? I just don't think I'm going to be able to drink it. I mean, it's not bad. It's just my stomach. It's too much padow. I don't know. It's a little too much. I'll probably sip it as we go. But so this is a local beer brewery. You would think that they would advertise the brewery more. I mean, do you see it anywhere? Am I missing it?
It's on the side. Yeah, you were looking at it. It's just really small print.
Yeah, the stork.
It's Hidden Springs Aleworks.
Okay.
There you go.
And you said that's near your office?
It's near my office, and they're kind of specialty are these sour ales that are all sorts of... They have one that tastes like Gatorade. Just weird stuff. But I actually remember this one. I like this one. I'm excited they put it back out. It's kind of an after-dinner beer.
Jarrett, as a sound engineer, do you recommend drinking with this much equipment around? Not that I have a ton of equipment, but, you know.
You know, it's your gear. You want to buy it again.
Also, on the first two episodes, I'm pretty sure he spilled beer like twice on both episodes.
That's where the patina comes from. That's where you get the soul.
You ever see like front of house consoles and venues? It says no drinks. There's a reason.
Yeah. I mean,
You ever see Sound City about the.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Josh, get up on that microphone.
I'm sorry, it's your dog's fault.
I know.
It's what she said. I just think with Fleetwood Mac alone recording there, like how much cocaine is mixed in with all the knobs and mic heads and everything else.
I mean, so there's a synthesizer somebody opened and it was the Deads and they got acid on themselves and
dripped.
I heard a story about a Trident console that belonged to Rick James, supposedly. I can't verify this, but apparently they pulled the faders out and down in the bucket at the chassis, like just cocaine.
Yeah, just like 3 inches of...
Like 3 inches of blow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, you know.
Does blow have an expiration date?
That's what I was going to say. I mean, it doesn't really go bad.
I wouldn't snort it, but... like dust and all kinds of like weirdness mixed in there.
Yeah, I mean...
Maybe you'd get like possessed by the soul of Rick James.
That would be amazing.
I'm going around saying, I'm Rick James, bitch.
Fuck this couch.
I don't want no cocaine on my console if I can help it.
I'd rather have cocaine than beer, though.
Yeah, it's too hard to clean it.
You're lucky if that's all you get with Fleetwood Mac in there, though. There's probably a little bit of Fleetwood and a little bit of Mac on.
Yeah.
True statement. So, Piney Point, Josh, have you heard they're dumping a bunch of fucking phosphate crap into the earth today?
I'm just going to prepare you that I'm the least aware of current events.
Well, they say that Piney Point phosphate mine is the reason that we're having all these outbreaks in Red Tide.
Yeah.
And
I mean, I've heard about it, and we go down to Anna Maria quite a bit, and we've noticed the red tide down there. So
the EPA, which I don't care who you are, I'm like the most distrustful motherfucker of the EPA. Like, they allow deodorant companies to put fucking cancer shit in our, you know, deodorant, and they don't care what's in our fucking whatever. You drink it, whatever you eat, they don't care. I don't know. They're just FDA and EPA, I just think, are crooked assholes. Anywho. So they're allowing Piney Point to basically pump 150 million gallons toxic fucking shit that was poured into the Gulf a couple years ago into a what they called, it was a drilled fucking
like a landfill.
It's not a landfill. It's below the aquifer of the water. So it's several thousand feet. It's like 3,200 feet. Of a drill, so it's under the aquifer. But you know, everybody's like, "Oh, this is going to poison our water," and then people are like, "No, it's safe." Eh. I don't think it's safe, but whatever. So in 5 years, when you know the kids start having green toes and
eyes,
you know, yeah. So and it's so close to us, you know, it's like literally across the county line right here.
Well, like you said about your dad, I think that's kind of where everything goes in my mind now is I don't know. I don't have enough time to know. Whatever they're telling me is probably not right. And so just...
History shows you that that's the fact.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The old Aaron Brock, they said that attorney got smoked. Did he die yet? But I think he's in federal prison or something.
Really?
Yeah. He took all sorts of money from clients. He got remarried to one of the housewives of Beverly Hills or Orange County, and he ended up getting thrown in prison.
Are you allowed to talk about the attorney that was recently murdered?
Sure.
What do you have to say about it? You knew him, right?
I did not know him. Know people surrounding it. Oh, okay. I know. So it's such a bizarre thing. So let me preface it with this: is I got some blowback for even commenting on.
I thought you just said you had some blow.
No. Yeah.
One conversation.
Yeah, sorry. No, that one I'm not talking about. No. I expressed some opinions about it because I kind of do that, and somebody that was involved in it kind of got on me about, you know, why am I even talking about it? It really doesn't have anything to do with me. So since you asked, I'll answer the question, but I'm not trying to, you know, insert myself into something that I'm not involved in. But what I thought was interesting about it is, you know, anytime there's a case with notoriety where someone's done something awful, the conversation in the cafeteria around the water cooler is always, would you represent that person? And, you know, my position is, yes, I would, because I think that's what you got to do. You know, you don't get to pick just the innocent people to represent. You got to represent whoever it is. And, you know, if we don't extend due process to the worst of us, then it doesn't mean anything. So what's interesting about this case, though, is this, for whatever reason, this surgeon was somehow tying his hopes to how this case went on this attorney, to the extent that he appears to have planned some pretty intricate, you know, murder, although he, you know, what came of it was kind of insane for other reasons.
It wasn't just so bizarre. I mean, the apparently the murder occurred and then he's on a Zoom hearing, like literally like minutes or 30 minutes afterwards or something.
From what the media says, he goes into this attorney's building, waits for him, and this attorney was being nice enough to let this client, who's is an opposing party, use his offices for depositions, so he didn't have to pay for depositions. Like, he didn't have to do that. This guy goes in there, you know, comes in with a bag with tasers, brass knuckles, some sort of sedatives,
protective vest,
you know. And now it's coming out that they had found him there like a month earlier doing something in the electrical room. But he goes through all this effort to kill this guy, and I just don't know what his thinking is, because I said it before and I'll say it again. Killing an attorney doesn't do anything other than kill that. It's not like that's the case is over. Somebody else just steps in and
right.
takes over. So all this planning, all this effort, all this whatever that he, you know, appears to have gone through to do this, I don't know what the goal was. And so, you know, my guess is eventually it's going to go into some sort of mental health defense for him, because his aim was so misguided. And not only that, the amount of effort it appears that he put into hiding this, he shit the bed on an epic scale between, you know, he's on a camera going in, he's on a camera going out, he takes a break between supposedly killing him and carting him away in his truck to get on the phone. And one of the worst facts about it is he asked the judge for attorney's fees because the attorney failed to appear for a court hearing when it appears that he just killed the guy. And then he drives home, gets caught on camera there, and then is driving the car around, and there's blood in the car and the bags in the car, and there's $300,000 cash in the car. And I just,
wow,
I don't know.
It's definitely going to be a Netflix movie.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Without a doubt.
For sure. But it's just sad because, I mean, everything I hear about this attorney is just a super, super sweet guy and was really nice to this nut. And, you know, he got killed for it. So it's a bummer.
Do you really think he can, like, do an insanity plea if he planned it? Like, he planned details. Of course, it didn't probably go to the plan. But I feel like insanity is, like, spur of the moment or, you know.
Well, I know the attorney that is representing him now, and he's a friend of mine. And when I was teaching at UT, I had him come out and talk to my students, and he's represented a number of serial killers. He's represented drug cartels. I don't know. I mean, he's as well represented as he can be. I don't think that insanity necessarily has to happen in the in the moment. It can be gestating over a period of time, but we'll see. It's going to be around for a while.
Jared, have you ever had a concert where some people were killed?
No, but I've been in the room with active shooter twice. I've been in riots. I've had riot squads come in and mace, 500 people. These are not metal shows. I just want to be really clear.
Mm-hmm.
This was in the late 90s. I did a lot of different kinds of music, hip hop. These were all hip hop shows. You know, I've pulled up in front of a venue and found, that there was a dead body in the parking lot. I have seen someone shoot through the front windows of a club. I have been trapped on the second floor of a club with a rioting crowd because the promoter took off with the money for a reggae show.
Were all Kiefer Sutherland shows. Yeah, exactly.
I think I'd start looking for a career change.
Well, interesting that you should say that, as funny as it is, because the last straw was one where there was shooting and my kids were like two. And I was like, I'm not doing this again. And I didn't do another hip hop show for almost 11 years. And then I got, started to do it on an arena scale, and arenas are far different than clubs. That shit doesn't really happen in that way.
It's amazing to me it doesn't happen more than it does.
Right.
Well, I told the person that hired me, I charged them an exuberant amount of money for the day, and I told them if it gets weird, I'm fucking leaving. Like, I'm doing monitors.
I told my last prostitute that. Yeah. Give me my money back.
If it doesn't get weird, I'm leaving.
But, I mean, I we've all seen some things. It's something that I think about a lot. I mean, I guess you're referring to what happened in Illinois.
Yeah.
I just want to say it's terrible to all the family, touring people, band people. I know a lot of people that were in the venue that were playing.
Mm-hmm.
My extreme condolences go out to everybody that was hurt.
Is this the roof or the shooting?
The roof.
Okay.
Yeah. And so, I text Trey, and he told me they were good, but yeah, he was kind of shooken up over it.
It's on all our minds. After Paris with the Eagles of Death Metal thing, for all of us touring people, it's on everybody's mind. In a lot of ways, we're still in the shadow of, El Rosa Villa with, Dimebag, and I've done that club a bunch, and it's really haunting to be on that stage and to look at how easy it was.
Right.
So
it's still a venue?
Oh, yeah. Well, it was pre-COVID. I haven't been out since then, but yeah, I just...
What was the Great White One where the...
Right, caught on fire.
Yeah.
It's the reason that you have to carry fire cert for every single banner in New England that you ever hang.
Wow.
You have to have a certificate or it ain't going up.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. They're not fucking around up there now.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, it makes sense, but...
Well, I mean...
Wouldn't that be like... It seemed like that would be like a nationwide thing.
I mean, you just get asked like religiously up there. I mean, everywhere wants to see it. And usually if you're a good tour manager, you send it with your advance.
Have you ever seen a Watain show?
Yeah.
Okay. So we go to a Watain concert. It's my first one, her first one. But I
smells good.
Oh, yeah. It's great. So they use a lot of pyrotechnics. I mean, live fire, fucking torches, like just going crazy with all their shit.
Totally.
And we're up, it's the Orpheum in Ybor before they moved. And we're sitting up in the VIP because that's, what we are now is our VIP people. Because
we need seats and we don't want to get elbowed or moshed on. I'm not going to be
like up front anymore. I'm kind of over that shit. So they've got the torches and they're coming out on stage. They're lighting their little, all the shit and all their torches on stage are lit. And he holds his main torch up that he used to light the other, torches. And the house goes dark. And then he just tosses the fucking torch into the crowd, and you can hear her because I'm videotaping it. You can hear her in the back go, "Oh my God." She's like, "Gah."
We all know that was you.
Yeah. Come on. So, I mean, people just, I don't know, man. They just play with fire. And it amazes me at shows how much bands still play with fire.
Yeah. I mean, my experiences with the fire thing are usually they're, very experienced pyrotechnic people. Like Raven 1349 did pyros for Immortal, and so his people do 1349's pyro, and it's big. There's a lot of fire when they're in Norway, not so much in America, but it feels pretty safe. The people there know what they're doing. They have it together, and they're not throwing torches in the crowd, that's for sure.
The lady that caught it, I'm pretty sure, had a baby like immediately. She was like, "Oh my God." She didn't expect it. Like, to me, I'd be like, okay, if I was throwing torches in the crowd, I would have like five people that knew the torch was going to them.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And it was planned. And it's like, hey, you guys are going to catch the fucking torch. This lady that he threw it to, no fucking clue. She ducks and like tries to miss it, and it hits the fucking ground.
When drumsticks aren't enough.
If you're taking a baby to a Watain concert,
no, I'm saying you know how to catch a torch. I'm not saying
you have caught. That's not your first torch. You caught plenty of torches.
I'm saying she had a baby just by the fucking fact of being shit scared.
Oh, well, all I thought about was the, I mean, I don't know the band. It was probably the one you guys were talking about. But the pyro, like, setting the curtains on fire and people dying and getting, like, trampled running light. Out. Yeah, okay, that one. So, like, as soon as the torch gets tossed into the audience, I start looking for fire exits. And I'm thinking I'm jumping off the stupid balcony. I do that into a
place no matter what. I'm looking at fire exits, like, immediately. I mean, I know Orpheum. I know that layout pretty well, the old one at least. So, but yeah, and any new venues and stuff, like when we saw King Diamond in Orlando, I immediately like, where's the exit? Where's the exit? And yeah, I don't know if I can play with that shit.
It's cool. I mean, you know, I mean, people have been doing pyros for years. I mean, think about Kiss, you know, somebody, you know, had to be there that knows, knowing what they're doing, I hope, anyway. But I, again, I don't think that I would endorse throwing anything fire-ish into the crowd.
It's a weird probably. Thing. Like, have you ever been at a show and been like, this is rad, but it needs more fire?
This sounds you will really not good think right that now, at a Watain concert.
I've definitely been at a show where I said it needs less
suck. Fire.
less suck.
Yeah.
I felt that way at Disney on Ice.
Yeah.
this needs fire.
Ground, yeah.
All right, guys. It is the time for top 10 list.
Are you going to leave the graphic up?
No, I'm not. Relax.
Okay. Always forget. Yeah. That's what I'm here for.
You need to lay off your audiovisual.
I'm trying, man. I'm maybe a pro.
He's going to pay her some hush money. Hey. So
just, this is the first show I've done all this with, so you know we're working it out. Yeah? Come on. All right, so top 10. This is just how it's labeled.
Oh, boy.
How great.
The richest metal bands of all time.
What website is it on? Because I feel like depending on the website you're at, it would probably differ.
Do we guess? Or is
you,
this,
can, you, just yeah, guess. Yeah, you can guess. You can guess. Yeah. It's, yeah. So we have... I think there's actually 11 that I listed. So,
good counting.
Who do you think number one is?
I mean, is
Metallica.
This,
well, yeah, Metallica, unless they consider Foo Fighters metal.
Metallica is number one at 1 billion.
What?
Wow.
That makes sense.
That's cute for them.
And I was kind of shocked at a couple of these. And one is fucking going to shock all of you. Because,
Iron Maiden.
Okay. They're 1, 2, 3. I don't have my pen. Where'd my pen go? They're number 1, 2, 3, 5. They're number 5.
Slayer.
Garby's just going to name all these himself.
Right. Too bad these weren't the questions on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Yeah. I know, right? Garbee was on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. He lost. All right. Hang on.
You're not a millionaire?
No. I lost $93,000 is what Ouch. It says on Google. Yeah.
On Google.
Yeah. Ouch. Okay, so we have Metallica at number one. We have Iron Maiden at number 5.
And he says Slayer.
There's at least one surprise
Slayer
on
Slayer is number 8 at really? 45 million.
Mm. I would say Motley probably did pretty well.
Motley Crue, $235 million. They're number 3.
Is Guns N' Roses considered metal?
Nope, they're not on the list.
That's because they snorted it all.
Judas Priest.
They grossed it. They
Judas Priest, number 7, $100 million. And I honestly thought they'd be higher, but yeah.
Mm. Nasty Savage. I'm just going by the patches behind your head.
What is? Did Megadeth make the list?
Oh, Megadeth. Yeah, they got
Megadeth was number 11. So technically, we are going to see Megadeth of our 11 or 10, but they made 11 at 25 million.
Can we please just throw in? We're going to see Megadeth in June.
We're going to see.
I'm going to be there with you too.
With Misfits, I'm more
there to see Misfits, but whatever.
Megadeth is on my list.
How many do we have so far?
So you have Metallica at 1 billion. You have Motley Crue at 235 million. Iron Maiden at 150 million. Judas Priest at 100 million, Slayer at 45 million, and Megadeth at 25 million.
Is Lamb of God on there?
Nope.
Pantera?
Nope.
What?
Wow, no Pantera.
These are, they're not, I mean, they're kind of commercial metal bands, but, so I mean, so.
Alice in Chains.
Nope.
Maybe at a point, maybe not anymore, but I mean, Zeppelin made and kept more money in the 70s than any band previously.
I just don't think they met this genre because genre is kind of like
Black Sabbath.
Mm. Number 6 went at 140 million.
Wow. Oh, then Ozzy Solo must come up somewhere.
He's not there.
No way.
No, well, I'm sorry. You're wrong. I'm wrong. You're right. Ozzy's number 2. Yeah. 220 million.
Yeah, I was going to say, Ozzy's got some good management, man. Yeah.
Would they call Twisted Sister metal?
No, but I mean, if Motley Crue was in but they just didn't make the list. They're probably somewhere. But
how many do we have left?
You have one. You have number 3 left.
I thought you said number 3 was Slayer or something.
No, I'm sorry. Number three is Motley Crue. You have number four. So my handwriting fucking sucks. You have number four left. You have number nine left. Number 10, you're never going to guess.
Never.
When I saw it, I was like, what? Literally?
The Beatles.
No.
Rat.
Nope.
We won't guess it because we don't know it or because it's just not, it's not metal.
Let me see if any of our viewers are guessing. Quiet Riot. Brian said Quiet Riot is not on the list, Brian.
Poison.
Alice Cooper. It's not really metal.
Nope. Yeah. I mean, I swear that one of these, I was like, what the fuck? Because they actually beat out Megadeth.
Soundgarden.
Which surprised the shit out of me.
I was going to go for Soundgarden, actually. No,
I don't think they're heavy enough.
I feel so good about my guess right now.
They're not heavy enough to be on the list. So, I mean, so we need number four and number nine.
Wait, Mastodon. 10. Mastodon.
Close. Ooh. Not quite. Think a band similar to that is outside of the norm that made the list.
Gojira?
Nope. Oh. But older than that. Older than that. We were listening to them when me and you were kids.
Anthrax.
Anthrax is on the list at number nine, 39 million.
Oh.
But not the one I'm thinking of.
I don't know, man. I'm at a loss.
Brian says Rammstein, not Rammstein.
Taylor
good
Swift.
Good guess, though. That's a good guess, Brian. Taylor Swift. Joe, do you have any guesses? Joe's cheating over there on Google. No,
probably.
Yeah.
I don't know enough about metal to...
Start giving some hints.
Yeah, give a hint.
All right, so let's go with number four. To me, doesn't meet this genre just because they're not, in my opinion, heavy, but somehow they're on here.
Don't say it. Just give a hint.
They have a cult following and...
not the cult. Marilyn Manson.
The cult?
No, it's not the cult. Marilyn Manson, I'm surprised, is not on the list, really, because...
Nine Inch Nails.
Nope. But number four, let's say, has a side project. That is also very well known.
Why don't you give a song? Or would I just give it away?
That would definitely give it away.
Nirvana.
Nope.
The Foo Fighters?
Nope. I don't think they... I mean, I'm sure they're up there, but they don't meet this crowd. Right. All right, so...
Or a letter.
Number... It starts with a T. Number... And it's something you have in your garage.
Tesla.
I mean, if you're... Yeah, maybe.
I mean, that was a good answer.
It was a very good answer.
Based on the clue.
Yeah, I was going to...
Tool.
It's a good one.
It is Tool, but literally my next guess or my next hint was going to be four letters. No, Tesla's
okay,
not
Tool.
Four letters.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. So Tool is number four with 200 million.
Okay.
Slipknot.
Ooh,
I'm surprised. You know what? I'm surprised they're not on the list. Really? They really should be on the list.
That surprises me.
They're not. All right, so I'm going to go out and just throw it out there, okay? And when you hear this, I swear to God, Exodus.
Are you shitting me?
I'm not. Exodus, bro. Number 10 at 33 million.
But I feel like they tour every day. They've never stopped touring ever.
That's real. Yeah,
I mean, but isn't that crazy? Brian says Gore, which Gore would probably maybe be. I think they sucked at money management, but I don't know.
Wait, Gore's on there?
No, they're not.
Okay, yeah.
That was just a guess from Brian.
Exodus.
I know.
I'm impressed.
I know. That's bro. When I saw Exodus, I was just like, really? We saw
Is
them.
Gary Holt still in Exodus? Or
they have the three mains. So their drummer is the only new member. Everybody else is original members.
Did you see, what was the documentary that they did about the Bay Area recently?
Oh, Blood on the Stage or something.
What's the
like
first lyric?
The Front Row.
Yeah, Burn in the Front Row. Yeah, it was a good movie.
Yeah, so Metallica with 1 billion, Ozzy with 220 million. You have Motley Crue, 235 million, Tool, 200 million, Iron Maiden, 150 million, Black Sabbath, 140 million, Judas Priest, 100 million. Slayer, 45 million, which I honestly thought Slayer would have more. Mm-hmm. Anthrax with 39, Exodus 33, and Megadeth with 25. I am just amazed that Exodus beat out Megadeth. I don't even see how that's possible, but
I know Megadeth just put it on an album, but then I feel like they hadn't had an album out for 10 plus years. I feel like Exodus puts an album out every 2 to 3 years.
Maybe, but
I don't know.
It's just, I figured Peace Sells fucking, maybe they just didn't get the rights to that or something.
Wait, this is a top 10 what? What's the...
The richest bands.
Metal bands.
Richest metal bands, yeah.
Yeah, but anybody's making money is touring. I mean, it's touring, right? It's not album sales for...
Back when Peace Sells, though, that's when they were cutting CDs and cassette tapes and shit.
I mean, definitely. I mean, there's still publishing off of that stuff. You know, that
it was
Yeah. And they're snorting it all. No, probably not. But, you know, being publishing for some of that stuff, they probably, I mean, if anybody cut a good deal, they're hopefully living off
but
it.
But isn't it ironic that you had Dave Mustaine, who used to be in Metallica? Metallica's at $1 billion and Mustaine's at the last at fucking $25 million. I mean, to me, it's like...
We had Hammett, who was in Exodus, then in Metallica. Mustaine, who's in Metallica, then in Megadeth. You have Kerry King, who was in Megadeth, then in Slayer. There's, it's this web of people that...
Weren't we talking about poly relationships earlier?
Polyamorous.
No, I think
polyamorous.
The... I think
so polyamorous musicians.
Yeah, I think the realist should be like richest musicians, because if they're all intermingled... And those bands, there's probably one that's
Dave Grohl. You
know. That is Dave Grohl.
Dave Grohl's like by a long shot. You can't turn on the TV without seeing him. And every concert, he's playing an instrument and whatever it is.
That's true.
Did you guys see Dave Grohl do Band on the Run at the White House with like McCartney and Stevie Wonder sitting in the front row?
No.
It's on YouTube. It's fantastic.
Wow. Like, it's that really, guy's really life, good. Man. He is just, I don't know how you can be more Dave Grohl than Dave Grohl. He's peak Grohl.
He looks like Timothy Leary on acid, kind of like, I don't know. To me, they look very like they could have the same dad.
I think you were on acid when you made that conclusion.
Maybe. Could have been.
I don't sit around and listen to the Foo Fighters much, but I definitely have a tremendous amount of respect for him for managing it and picking up the pieces after his, you know, band falls apart, you know, and then becoming what he is. Like I said, I'm not throwing it on for enjoyment necessarily, but I respect it for sure.
Twice.
Yeah.
Right.
Now,
right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Twice. I didn't even think about that.
That's impressive. All right. So, and check this out. Drew's stock picks.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, I'm going to go to the bathroom.
No. So, I do want to mention one stock that I want to talk about, and I think it's worth talking about, is Mullen, M-U-L-N. They're a startup.
Not to confuse with Mueller.
No. Startup EV company. They're at 0.1045, so basically just over 10 cents a share. I think this is a good buy. They've had a shit ton of like good news come out lately. It is a risky play because it's a startup company. They need to get to $1 per share before they get knocked off of the NASDAQ, but I think they will do it. So look it up, M-U-L-N, Mullen. Josh, you trading any stocks?
Nope.
Okay. Jarrett, you trading stocks? Debt. Yeah. Okay.
No, I have like a really bad gear addiction. Like that's where my money goes to. Yeah. It's really bad. My partner Jeremy and I in the business were just—it's like children.
I mean, but you'd be surprised at how much stock you can buy for $100 these days, especially these little penny stocks, 10 cents a share.
It's true.
You hold them for 5 years, or you know, it's like okay. I mean, you can go to the casino and spend $100 and make $3,000. You could spend $100 on Mullen and maybe in
lose $100.
10 years, be a millionaire. You never know.
I can save myself the time by walking into the casino and taking my wallet and throwing it in the fucking trash.
That's very true. That's very true. I don't really gamble. Garby's a good gambler. He actually makes money when he gambles, unless he's listening to me.
Unless he's on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Right, yeah. That was a bad gamble.
That was a bad gamble. Bad gamble. All right, I want to watch this one more time, Garbee.
This one's going out to the Drinking with Drew show. Kirby, oh my god, I'm sorry I missed you on the last one. I heard you cried like a little bitch in front of all four viewers. You guys really need to get some more viewers. I'm so sorry. It was such a long list.
So, but doesn't it seem like she dressed up for you this time?
She did.
She did.
Like the last one we did, she was like...
If somebody accidentally texts me this, I won't complain.
I know, right? I mean, so...
Joe already did. Don't worry, Joe did.
I didn't mean to miss you. That was completely unintentional. So, Garbee, this is just for you.
Look, you can hear she's wearing heels. Can you hear the heels clapping the concrete or whatever the fuck she's like?
Yeah.
So I'm curious if she was like about to go on set or because she was so made up.
Maybe I was her fluffer.
You were her fluffer. That's see, I like it.
Who wants to be a millionaire? Because who doesn't? But. Oh, well, hopefully you'll have fun on the Drinking with Juice.
Can we talk about that real quick and just rehash how you lost on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Sure.
Again?
Yeah. Again.
Which part do you want to hear?
Just how you lost.
Final question.
Two-minute version.
I was on the $250,000 question. I had $125,000 I could have left with, but I thought, why do that when I can guess and get it wrong? And
who was the host?
It was Meredith Vieira.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So... Who you called your dad?
So yeah, the question before I didn't have any lifelines left. Yeah, for the 250, because the question before I had called my dad,
and he was with my grandfather and two of the smartest guys you'll ever meet. And so the question was, United Nations Day is on the 24th of what month? And the choices were April, May, August, October. And you get 30 seconds for the phone. And so I said, Dad, I read the question. He says, okay, hold on. Goes, confers with my grandfather, gets back on. He says, September. I said, Dad, that's not a choice. He said, all right, give it to me again. I said, okay, April, May, August, October. He says, okay, hang on. Goes back a couple seconds, gets back on the phone. He's like, all we've got is September. I'm like, Dad, what are you doing to me?
So, is there an appeal process?
Yeah. So I hang up and I look at Meredith. I'm like, did he just say September? And she said, yeah, I wouldn't go with that. I was like, okay, thanks. Yeah. So I used 50-50 and for different reasons. I knew it wasn't April. The choices
this
were
camera's
left
blurring out on this.
The choices left were April and October. Yeah, and I knew it wasn't April for a different reason. And so I went with October. That was right. And then I got to the next question and I just took a guess and got it wrong. Uh-huh. Lost $93,000. Yeah. I was 23 years old. I figured, you know what? Why not? I'll just give it a shot.
Did you blow it off or years of therapy or what? So,
yeah. I traveled with it. It was mostly traveling. I invested some in the beginning and then ended up cashing that out and traveling.
Is your humble investment?
Yeah. It's all in the humble now. Right now. It's all in humble.
It's another one of my stock picks he bought. Okay, anybody have any last minute, any rants? You drove from Orlando to Riverview. Do you have any rants on your drive? Anybody piss you off? Anybody you want to kill? Anything going?
How bad I-4 sucks.
You took the back road, so
no,
that
I
was
took
smart.
The back roads. Yeah,
yeah. So Jarrett holds the record now for the longest traveling guest for the Drinking with Drew show. He drove from Orlando to Riverview to be on the show. So
how long did it take you?
2 hours, maybe.
Oof. Oh, my God.
It's impressive.
I was going to bitch the entire time about my driving.
Well, Garbee comes from what?
Yeah, Trinity.
Trinity.
Yeah,
every hour, Tuesday. Yes. Joe, he wins the award for the closest Trinity visitor because he walks across the fucking street.
Well, I think Laura wins that one.
Well,
yeah, it's me. Yeah,
I don't count her as a guest.
She walks. She walks out of your dungeon.
She's our beer. She's the beer wench. She walks out of the dungeon. Sometimes she leaves her handcuffs on.
I mean, you can't leave Orlando without planning for traffic. I'll say that.
That's true.
Same with Riverview.
Leave or go to Orlando.
No. Yeah. I mean, it's a nightmare around Disney. It's a parking lot, no matter what you do.
Yep.
All right. Well, I think we will call it a night, guys. We're over an hour at an hour and 16 minutes.
Good job.
I think that qualifies as a record, right? Who knows?
No, that 2.5 hour one, whatever it was in the garage.
That's true. We did have a 2.5 hour episode when we were all drinking. This is when we had our cameras in the garage and we were just fucking
BSing.
Around. All right. Jared, you might recognize this one. Old school. All right, guys. Drinking with Drew. Appreciate y'all for hanging out. We'll be back next Tuesday. Josh Sheridan, Tampa attorney. Thank you for coming out.
Thank you for having me.
Jarrett Pritchard, world-renowned music man and producer. Any websites you want to pimp before you...
Nah, just go listen to Polka Morte since that's what I'm playing these days.
Okay. Josh Sheridan, do you want to pimp a site out?
Oh, you're going on the Garbee.
I was going to, but then I forgot that I didn't ask Josh about his website.
Or his band.
Oh, and his band.
MyTampaFirm.com, Prisoner Hostage, Slayer, spelled like Slayer with a W in there. That's it.
Two separate bands?
Actually, there's another one called Burial. The three.
Man, you're too busy.
Wow.
Slow down over there.
Yeah.
Greg Garbee, thank you for coming out.
Yeah.
And are you going to go home and have a battle with the wife?
Oh, yeah.
Don't call her Katie tonight, okay?
Oh, Jesus.
Joe, thank you for hanging out and controlling Simon, even though you're not on camera or mic tonight. You're always an important part of the show.
Oh, gosh. Whoa. What is that?
Yeah, Josh, I probably will need a card if you want to. All
right. I do all a right, discount guys. For guests of the show.
Thanks. Whew, I ran past our trailer music. Okay. Well, fuck it. We're out. Have a good one.
Oh,
wrong one.
That's for you.
What? You flicked me a bird?
Yeah.
Why?
You were just leaving without me saying bye.
I mean, you're kind of an employee of the show. Okay. Laura.
Nope. Don't want it.
What do you want? What's your random rant?
No, I was just trying to say bye. We were going down the line. This is the rant. My rant is now. You were just cutting me off again.
Okay. Well, you know, we're trying to make it work here. Sorry, guys. All right. Next Tuesday, we'll be here. Thank you for checking us out and watching the live video. We'll have the edited video up probably by Friday. Peace out.